This event brought together bikers from all over Europe. Adventists offered the crowd food, books, and health checks, all for free. Musicians provided live music on stage as people lined up at a booth nearby to donate blood. The Adventist Motorcycle Ministry team is implementing Christ's method of ministry by connecting with people who have similar interests and mingling with them, creating an opening for attendees to learn about Jesus.
An event like this is important because many different people from many different cities or many different countries can come and be together. They can learn from each other, they can get along, and they can have a good time together.
People gathered to talk and admire each other's bikes. The quality time allowed new friendships to develop and deeper conversations to take place.
Reactions of people is really wonderful. In this motorbike fest, you can see people who want to help you, people who want to be friends with you, and who want to speak with you, and we want to reach people for Jesus during these things.
More than 400 books from the Serbian Adventist Publishing House were distributed. One of the most popular was Steps to Christ.
Every heart who will came, every soul who will came, and every soul who will read Step to Christ, I think can feel Jesus in his or her heart.
We can teach them it's another way, a better way to be with God, to be near God, and to have a different life, a better life.
This event piqued Zelimir's interest because it was different from other motorcycle festivals he'd attended. After 62 consecutive days of riding and attending motorcycle events, Zelimir made sure to end his journey here. He expressed great appreciation for the unique programs and people.
I hope more events like this continue, and that we can have friendship together and ride together.
After seeing the turnout for this festival, the Adventist Motorcycle Ministry team was encouraged to do even more.
My heart is full because a lot of people came. We want to reach people for Jesus, that people can see that someone can live different, without drugs, without alcohol, without immoral, and that heart will be full of Jesus and expect Jesus like his or her Savior.
God has a plan for each person who attended this event. Please pray for the Adventist Motorcycle Ministry in Serbia. Pray that people will come to know Jesus as a result of this creative ministry. Thank you for supporting mission.
Good morning, everybody. Sure good to see you here today. Beautiful Sabbath day, holiday weekend. I hope you have been reflecting on the liberty that we have to worship in freedom. It's not that way in every country in the world, and we live in this country. I heard Ron Kelly this morning talking from the Village Church in Berrien Springs about the Declaration of Independence. It was very, very inspiring, and would recommend it to you. For those of you who are here today, if you would like to communicate with the church in any way, we have these, what's called a Let's Connect card, and we could have you fill those out and just drop them in and give them to one of us, an elder or somebody, or simply put them in the little wooden church in the back with a hole in the roof. That's what it's there for. I'm going to let the go ahead, Kat, if you can get that. Get it. There we go. Thank you. There we go. Today is a very important day for Judy Carson. She is going to have a meeting after the church today for all of those that are involved with the parade on Thursday. That's this will be the primary meeting, I assume, before that. So after church services today, just stay here in the sanctuary, and Judy will be sharing some very important details with you about that event. So don't forget. And if you know somebody that's involved with that whole thing, make sure they stay here. Today we do not have a potluck. We apologize to our visitors for that. We will have a potluck next week, however. And July 8, next week as well, 4 o'clock in the afternoon, there's a children's program at Rick Caudill's. They're calling it a hootenanny. Wish I knew where that word originated. And then at 5:30, there will be a supper for all. The details are on the screen as well as in your bulletin. A very exciting event is coming up here on July 10 to 14. Giancarlo Miranda will be with us for a series of prophecy meetings, and that will start again on a week and 2 days from today. So please plan, get that on your schedule. The same time, we have a VBS program going, so the people that come can bring their children. There will be a VBS program for the adults. There will be the prophecy program in here. Yes.
Since we're talking about the prophecy seminar, yes, just we're going to be providing a served meal each night of that seminar, and we're going to be recruiting folks to help serve the meal and clean up afterwards. So my number's in the bulletin. I'm Don, in case you don't know me. And if you would reach out to me, if you'd be interested to help serve and clean up for that served meal, I would appreciate it. Also, since it's so beautiful outside, I'm going to go up to Faraday today at 3 o'clock and either bike or hike. I haven't decided which, but if you'd like to join me up there for some fellowship, you're more than welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Don. By the way, somebody found out in the foyer a little thumb drive. I'm hoping it's the code to a Swiss bank account or something. But if not, it's yours. Okay. I'll get it to Larry. Tuesday, July 25, that's a ways off yet, but just start to think about it. We have another Lifeline screening coming to the church, and I know a number of you have taken advantage of that over the years, and if there's someone that hasn't, then you can call that number or talk to Carol. She knows pretty much all the details about it. And way out, we've got September 9 and 11, we have Bible school training that's going to be taking place here. Kurt Johnson, who has been the driver behind the Discover Bible Lessons, as a personal friend, and he's agreed to come. He's been with the Voice of Prophecy for like 40 years or something, long time anyway. He'll be coming here to head up that teaching event on that weekend. We have church members that are needed for the Adventurer Club. Please contact Eric or Annette Moore if you're willing to help. We have a lot of kids, and the kids need loving and caring adults to help them out. We have birthdays. Take a look at that. Dan Lott, 4th of July. Really? Whoa. Oh, I'm not supposed to say anything? Okay, I won't. I've got you one up, though. I was born on my birthday, so there. All right. Okay. Tithes and offerings. We want to thank you for being faithful. And again, we don't pass the plate here. We just let everybody respond in the little wooden church in the back. And Dennis has a word for us right now.
So there's a couple of events going on this week. Well, this month. One going on this week. I would like a couple of individuals, three, four of us, we can do both sides of the street. I want to walk the parade route and pray over the individuals, over the float. Thursday, the parade starts at 7 o'clock, right? So if you're interested, you can send me a text. My phone number is in the bulletin under the prayer request. Or let me know via email, but I'll be meeting at the, I think it's Minock Park, the one right here up. If you go all the way, you hit the red light and hit the street, it's Minock, okay, that park, within walking distance of the end of the parade route. So I'll meet you there at 5 p.m. Thursday night, and hopefully I'll see two or three of you there. That would be great. Also, I'd like a few individuals to pray come the evangelism series we have starting the 10th. Meet here at 6 o'clock, 30 minutes prior to dinner. We can pray over the series, pray over the individuals who are coming, and let God work miracles on the hearts that come. Thank you.
Okay, at this time we're going to have our children's story and the Lamb's offering. The children will come around to receive that from you at this time. We have a special guest here today. I don't believe I know you, sir. We'll have to see what that's all about. So,
test. I see all the children come on up. I got a fun story for you today. Actually, before the story, you probably wonder why I'm dressed in this this Hollow Monkey outfit. But this is my original naval uniform. I still fit in it. In fact, I'm skinnier now than I was when I was in the Navy. So I even have extra room in my uniform. Less wrinkles, and in the Navy, I have to tell you, they don't let you have long hair. Your hair is right down to your skin, essentially. We've got just two today? Okay, well, that's all right. I'll show you. This was the, when I entered the Navy, I ended up as a sonar technician on a submarine. And this is a model of my submarine. It was it was called a 640 class fleet ballistic missile nuclear submarine. So I spent 3 years on this submarine. And the longest I had to go down, I talked to Tim about this before, and so I'll try to leave out those details. He doesn't like talking about the depths of the ocean. The longest period of time that I was under the water for a single period of time without ever seeing the surface was 2 months and 1 week. So if you're in a steel tube with 140 men for over 2 months, there's some interesting stories, but they don't belong here in church, most of them. But I do have one fun story that I'll share this week. This is after I actually left active service, and I would have active service once a month for a weekend. And so we lived in San Diego, California. If you see, can you see it up there? Okay. We go out to sea on various submarines, and this was a fun submarine. I don't remember the name of it now, it's been too many years. But God watches over each one of us, even if you're on a boat or on a submarine. God wants us to be safe and happy, but sometimes we make it hard for Him to help us if we do risky things. This is a story about when I went out to sea on an old World War II diesel submarine in San Diego, California. And the picture you see here is it was a sister ship to the submarines I went out to on that day. Okay? We enjoyed diving down and surfacing up in our submarine. We did it all day long. Just dive down and back up. So we just had a lot of fun near the islands off of San Diego. And I have to tell you, when the submarine goes down, we went down like this. And so you have 1 foot on the floor and the other foot on the wall. And so if you don't, you end up falling against the wall. So you really have to kind of get used to getting your sea legs on a real submarine. And it was. And then we returned to San Diego Harbor, but we were submerged. And so we came right into San Diego Harbor, under the water. And our captain, now this is not our captain. I want you to know that. But this was our submarine. This was the submarine that we were on. And that was the actual periscope that he used. And he raised the periscope to look to see if the coast was clear so we could surface the submarine. And he didn't say a whole lot to us. But what we didn't realize at the moment was that there's many boats that were also returning to San Diego Harbor that very same Sunday afternoon. Yeah, from another bridge back there. And so then our captain gave the order to the pilots to surface the submarine, and that's the actual place where they steer it, and they raise and lower the submarine right there. And so my job was, I was the lookout. I'm the man with the binoculars that goes out there, and you open the hatch, the first guy out, and jump up the hatch right under that right part of the sail up there. And so that was the, this is a sister ship to the submarine that had a little different sail. So I jumped up there, and I looked out, and I was so surprised to see we had just surfaced right in between several sailboats in San Diego Harbor. And I looked down at those poor people in the sailboats, and they had the look of awe and shaw on their faces. But we certainly did. And I hate to say it, I was the first one on the submarine to see them and look at their faces. And so they had a surprising shock. And it was also the faces of the people in the sailboats as they suddenly saw a big submarine pop right up next to them. And one of the shocked people on the sailboat that we surfaced to was a member here at Sandy, Brad Norton. Brad, can you just tell us quickly what you thought when that submarine popped up next to you? Well, I tell you what, a 500-ton submarine has a little trouble in stopping. I was the one up on top of the binoculars. That's right. That was me. From here, this is about 1,600 miles to San Diego, roughly. I don't know. Yeah, we were just talking over lunch a couple of weeks ago here at Potluck, and I just happened to mention my story, and Brad says, "You know, that happened to me. I was in San Diego. Well, when was this?" And we found it was the same date. We go, "Oh my goodness, that was us." Anyway. I want to say that this is just a fun story, but I thank God that He kept everyone safe in a very risky situation. God loves us, even if we're on a big submarine or out in a little sailboat. Thank you very much. God bless you.
The love of Jesus will find you wherever you're at the depths of the ocean or in the highest mountain. Jesus will find us there. So we come together this morning to worship Him, to praise Him. We're going to begin with a familiar hymn, but we're going to change it up a little bit, because when we praise God, sometimes it's better if we praise Him directly. And this hymn, as you know it, is "'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus." And we do all want to be in Jesus, but we're going to seek Him this morning as a praise song. And where you're used to saying "in Jesus," we're going to say "you, Jesus." So make sure you follow the slides. the words on the slides as we sing to Jesus.
You are the one we adore.
Well, we haven't done this for a while. We're going to have a prayer and praise time now, where you can kind of share, and if a couple guys could get the mics here. While they're doing that, and while you're thinking about what you'd like to praise God for, I want to praise God for each of you. Last week, we had a huge turnout. We knew there was going to be an increase, but we had no idea. And I can't tell you how proud I was to see how many of you stepped up to the plate and got things done, tables moved, places set up. We were eating all over the church. And I had a friend from Kelso that sent me a note this last week and said, "What a wonderful congregation. We felt so welcomed." And I just want to thank each of you. And Don, your kitchen crew, you and your kitchen crew were amazing. Thank you so much. And I heard some banging around in the bathroom. I went and looked, and it was Tim, and he was putting in hand towels. He said, "This is my, I think he said, my ninth package." So he was going around keeping everything working. Anyway, just everybody just kind of stepped in and did what had to be done, and it really worked out. And I know Dr. Vine was very grateful for everything, and a lot of people were blessed. So thank you to you, first of all. Okay, so, oh, sorry. I know you.
Last year, right after the dental clinic, we showed photos of a lady who we helped get a flipper for the front of her mouth. We had before and after pictures. That was Mary. Mary works at the Eagle Creek feed store, and she's become a friend of mine. And I have been kind of dialoguing with her when I've been down there and found out that she has been diagnosed with a glioblastoma brain tumor. And they cannot operate on it because of the size of it. And so they're having to go in next Thursday, drill into her head and place chemo wafers to try to get that brain tumor to go down. So if you happen to go into the feed store, let her know that you're praying for her, and please keep her in your prayers.
Thank you. Anybody else?
I'm so excited and pleased that the Gainers are here today. Leanne was my boss for 10 years, and it was hard retiring and saying goodbye. So we have a lot of sweet memories. Welcome.
Yeah, I'm grateful that the Gainers are here as well. George and Leanne, boy, it's been a long time. Colleagues, and he was my pastor. He was our pastor for a number of years until we got infected by Sandy, and then we came out here.
I want to thank everybody that participates in the meal train. I think Kat runs that. Thank you, Kat. It's been such a blessing. I don't know if you guys know, there was a new member that, not a member, but a person that comes in. So she is kind of like a member, right? It's a family coming into our church. Anybody that comes in here should be treated like family, which I am so grateful for everybody that has treated her like family. This is Jesus. She's been coming off and on for, I think, 2 years to different activities. Don connected her with us, and we've done a wraparound treatment of just loving on her. And everybody that has brought her food into her home has blessed her with God's love. And I want to thank every single person that does not know her that has gone out of their way to minister God's love. And I am truly, truly grateful because of you, she's able to maybe see things a little bit differently. So thank you to every single one of you guys that participate in the food train. And if you have not, I highly encourage you to do it, because you build strong connections with every person that needs a little bit of love. And that is it. Thank you, guys.
Thank you very much. That is a wonderful ministry. Thank you, Kat. Okay, well, we're just grateful that each of you are here today, and we're so pleased that we have a lot of visitors and a lot of friends, a lot of things that the church is doing to be the, as they say, the hands and feet of Christ in the community, and thankful for all of you that help with those various events. I'm going to pray at this time, and then following prayer, we will have a scripture, and then I will introduce our speaker. And please bow with me. Our Heavenly Father, we are so grateful to be able to bow to you and to speak and praise your name. Thank you, Father, for the things that you've done for us, for the blessings of this church, for this building, for this community, and for this congregation. Please, Lord, I ask for your blessing to be upon each and every family represented here, those who are present as well as those who are not. We thank you, Lord, for this country that we live in. As we look to the celebration of our freedoms, we know that those freedoms were given by you. And we know that we are living in a time where we see much of that being eroded, especially in the area of religious liberty. And so we pray, Lord, that you will hold back the winds and allow us to do the work that you've given us to do. Please bless us, Lord, with opportunities so that we can share the studies in the Word, that we can meet with people and help them and in their distress and their challenges. That's what we're here for, Lord. Please guide and direct us. And please help us, Lord, to find those in the Hoodland area that you are working with, that you are guiding and directing, people who are seeking a deeper walk with you. Lord, we thank you that today we are here in freedom, and we know that that will not always be the case. Prophecy is sure. And so prepare us also for those days that are ahead by speaking to our hearts, by speaking to our the opportunities we have to grow in your grace, study your word, to deepen our connection with you, and to truly be fully surrendered to your love. Lord, we ask your blessing upon Pastor George as he shares with us today. We pray, Father, for the word to speak to our hearts, your spirit to guide us, direct us, that we might go from this place today having grown in your grace. Thank you, Father, for all these things. In Jesus' name, amen. The scripture this morning is from the book of Micah, chapter 6. We'll be reading verses 6 through 8. Verse 8 is familiar to many of you, but maybe not 6 and 7 so much. Micah 6, verses 6 through 8. The prophet asks the question, With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before the high God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has shown you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God? Pastor George Gaynor pastored the Pleasant Valley Church for 1 month short of 24 years. Whew. And during that time, he blessed a lot of people. And he's now retired, but he has another attachment to his name that he'll be sharing with us. George Leanne, welcome, and thank you, George, for being here. The time is yours.
I was glad when they said, let us go to the house of the Lord. Amen. When I say good morning, good church family, that's how Leanne and I feel. It has been such a warm welcome we've received. And we know we have a lot of friends that we've known over the years. And some of you I've seen at camp meeting. And I know some of you I've seen at places like, the ABC. So this just feels like home being here today. And we just feel so grateful to Pastor Diego for the invitation to come and be here today and to be able to share together. We know and we recognize, and you know this, and that is we don't live in normal times, do we? These are not normal. People think, oh, now that the pandemic's over, we'll get back to normal, right? Everything will get back to usual. No, that's not happening. And I know that as you were able to be here last Sabbath and hear Conrad Vine, as he came and made his presentations. And I want you to know that Leanne and I guess I'm going to say a thank you to Jeff for this. I don't know who did it, but somebody put all of his presentations up and we were able to come and be with you. We were actually at the Auburn camp meeting, the Washington camp meeting last Sabbath. And up till Friday afternoon, I thought, we're going to get up at 6 in the morning and drive from Auburn and come straight here so we can be here with Sandy. And then the lady we were working with, her mother had a situation that happened medically, and we ended up having to stay. And I went, oh, no, but I'm so grateful, Jeff, for you having put those up so you, Leanne and I, could participate with you and to hear that message that was presented. And so to know that, and to know that we are now called to share the good news of Jesus Christ, now get this, the good news of Jesus Christ in the context of the three angels, which is the time in which we now live. And so that's the calling that we have, and that is how we're going today to open the Word of God and to see what God has to show us in terms of how to be His people, and that this loud cry that's coming, a loud cry that Sister White says, that it'll go to all around the world, and that multitudes around the world will come and respond to the message of Christ our righteousness. So let's pray together as we go into God's Word today. And before we do that, Larry, thank you for your story. That is just amazing that both of you men are in the same congregation. Isn't God good? Isn't it good that you didn't take his boat out on that experience? So, okay. So, all right, let's pray together. Lord God, thank you so much for the privilege to be here in the name of Jesus Christ. We give you thanks for every blessing you pour into our lives through Christ Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege of being part of the family of God, to be here together to worship you and to again seek your face. And it's our prayer this day that, Lord, as we open these holy scriptures, that your Holy Spirit, who inspired these words, will bring them to not only our ears, but to our minds and to our hearts, where we are called to say yes to you. So this is our prayer this morning. We thank you for hearing and for promising to answer in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's go to Matthew 24. Beginning in verse 12, And you know that this is the passage of Scripture where Jesus is speaking, and he's saying, look, there are going to be wars and rumors of wars. There'll be pestilences. There'll be earthquakes. He's talking about the signs of Christ's coming. And then he comes to a sign that we don't often think of as a sign of Christ's coming, but boy, do we know it is in the time in which we lived in the last couple of years in the world we see as it is right now. And because lawlessness will abound. Because lawlessness will abound. Anybody experienced that one? Oh my. For those of us who lived in the Northwest, for those of us who lived in the Portland area, we know what has happened in this place. We know that when Leanne and I moved here almost 30 years ago from Washington, D.C., and we moved here to the great Pacific Northwest, we came to Portland and said, this is the most beautiful city we've ever experienced in our lives. We even let our kids go downtown as teenagers on Saturday nights with other kids. It was just an amazing city. Wow. Because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. Now that love word, if you go and look that up in the Greek, you'll discover that that love word is the word agape. Agape, self-giving, self-sacrificing love. And it says here that the love, the agape of many, but love, self-giving, self-sacrificing, that's love. That's what makes this world a beautiful place to be. Wherever beauty, the beauty of God that shines through, it's because of agape. Amen? I mean, we know that, you know, in the New Testament, there's eros and there's storge. Let's see, eros, the love of desire. It could be, it could be strawberry shortcake. Okay, there we go. But eros and storge, familial love. And then this philia, which is the brotherly love, Philadelphia, we know that word. These three, it seems like those three keep occurring because of God's common grace in this world that he pours out. His rain falls on the just and on the unjust. That keeps happening. Eros, storge, and philias. But this agape thing, Romans 5:5 says, God pours his agape into our hearts through the Spirit whom he's given us. This is God's presence. The fruit of the Spirit is agape. What in the world does it mean for a world? What will happen to a world where agape, the love of many, will grow cold? What is happening in a world where agape is being quantitatively diminished? Think about that. The world, agape, self-giving, self-sacrificing love, is being quantitatively diminished. We use a phrase that talks about where the Spirit of God being withdrawn from the world. By the way, God doesn't go, okay, I'm turning around, walking, I'm done with you. No, what it is, God's Spirit is being beaten away with a stick. I mean, this is a world turning against God, going, no, we don't want you, we don't want you, we don't want you. And he keeps reaching, and this is the world that we're in. Now, I'm going to say this much in this part of it, and that is, I am so thankful that the verse does not say that the love of all, that the agape of all will grow cold. It says the love of many. You know what that tells me? In the midst of this mess, there will be agape lovers who are being filled with the Holy Spirit. And in those agape lovers are the ones who will then, because of their love, will be given permission to actually speak the word of hope that we have and to be able to share the good news of Jesus. Amen? You see that thing? That is we, that love of God, agape lovers in the world, that's who we were created to be. When I say agape lovers, let's see, 1 John 4:8, God is love, God is agape. And if you were made, I were made in the image of God, if we're created in God's image, then that means that we were created to be agape lovers. That's where my phrase comes from. That's who we are called to be. And that's what this, here we are now, broken people, children of Adam and Eve. Yeah, broken people because of the fall. But here's God's restoration through the one who will come and crush the serpent's head. And now through the Spirit pours his agape into our hearts. And the fruit of the Spirit is agape. Singular. Fruit of the Spirit is agape, singular. And then, of course, you put that prism up there and it goes, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, just that whole beautiful God's rainbow, amen? That beautiful rainbow through that prism of agape, and there it all goes, and that's who you and I are called to be in this world. What does he say? Because of lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold, but not the love of all. And that people, in fact, I'm going to call those people God's remnant. The people who say yes to Jesus Christ and who are going, yes, I'm going to follow you. Yes, I say yes to the leading of the Spirit. Yes, Jesus is my Lord and Savior. Those are the ones who will endure to the end. And the ones who endure to the end will be saved. By the way, when I think about that word endure, as I think about the word endure, I would say, I would remember it this way, that I have never had to endure a day at Cannon Beach. I love Cannon Beach. That's one of our favorite places. And when we moved to the Northwest, we're going, oh my. I mean, we love the beaches back east. Virginia Beach and Myrtle Beach and Daytona Beach. We love the beaches back east. You can swim all day long out there and not freeze, okay? It's nice, nice water. But to come out here and see the beauty there from Ecola Point and just look, oh my. We love going. I have never had to endure. Even on the days, Dick, when we had prayer conferences out there with the pastors, and it would rain or something like that, and just wind and blow. And one day I walked up the beach, and I'm so glad I had my gear, because it not only rained on me, it hailed on me. The wind about blew me off the beach. I loved it. I came back so energized, okay? So I've never had to endure. What this tells me is he, she, who endures to the end. To endure means that we're going to be in a world where love, joy, peace, patience. Anybody driven on the 205 lately? Okay, patience, I mean, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, all those things are quantitatively diminished. Whoa, what does it look like to be those who endure to the end? Here's the interesting part. The ESV, English Standard Version, we're with the NKJV this morning, because I love, those are my two favorite translations. But the ESV, that word endurance pops up again in Revelation 14:12. Let's go there. Revelation 14:12. This is our, as Seventh-day Adventists, our identity text. This is where we find our calling. Here is the patience of the saints. That word patience, in the ESV it says, here is the endurance of the saints. Here's the endurance. The patience. Here's the endurance of the saints. What does it look like to endure to the end in a world where the love of many grows cold and lawlessness seems to reign? Here are those who keep the commandments of God, get this, in a time of lawlessness. This is the remnant. The remnant will be those who keep the commandments of God in a time of lawlessness and the faith of Jesus. And that faith of Jesus can be understood in two ways. One is, it's the faith of Jesus who there in the Garden of Gethsemane said, not my will but yours be done. And there is one Lord, one faith, one baptism. It's his faith that then it becomes our salvation because of what he stood for, and he becomes our righteousness. It also can be understood as the faith of Jesus being that we ourselves now exercise that faith. And so it's really speaking to our receiving of the gospel. So here are the people of God who are living by the good news of Jesus Christ, who are keeping the commandments of God in a time of lawlessness. This is what it looks like as we endure. And now let's go back to Matthew 24, and we go to verse 14, and look at this. These who are keeping the commandments of God in the time of lawlessness and the faith of Jesus, this good news of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations. Then the end will come. We are sharing the good news of Christ in the midst of the mess of our world. In all this mess, and all of this despair, I just read and heard, and in fact, Conrad Vine spoke of it just last Sabbath when he talked about the deaths of despair and how it's gone not just from the middle-aged white guys, it's gone now to the teenagers. We see it on the streets around us every day, at least where we live. So he says that this good news of the kingdom, we're going to be preaching the good news of the kingdom in the midst of this mess. So here, let's summarize this and say, in the midst of everything happening in this world, and everything everything that can be shaken being shaken, and everything coming loose, and the world spiraling down. In the midst of this, God has a people, and will have a people, who are a people of hope. I had a guy say to me once, my neighbor, he said, you people are the doomsdayers. And I said, no. The fact we say Jesus is coming again makes us doomsdayers. No. We are not the doomsdayers. We're the people of hope. And as the world comes unglued, the rest of the world is going into despair, because they've got nowhere to hope as everything shakes loose. So, people of hope who are this good news of the kingdom, we're people of hope, we are good newsers, and we are agape lovers. Those three, that's who we get to be. People of hope, good newsers, and agape lovers. That who God has called us. Now, this love thing, let's think about it for a moment. Let's see. I'm going to date myself here with a song that I remember from my youth. What the world needs now is... Oh, you're all... Okay, all right. It's the only thing there's just too little of. I mean, this wasn't even written by a contemporary Christian artist. You see, the world knows what it needs. I mean, all around us, everyone we see, even those who are shaking their fist at God, are all image bearers. We've all been created in the image of God. I mean, this is why we hold up and protect every life, because we're saying, hey, all around us, whoever you are, you have worth and you have value. And so that's who we're called to be as we look at this. So this love, the world says, we need love. We need sweet love. It's the only thing there's just too little of in this world. And the world, our world is very clear. So what you and I are called to do as agape lovers, we're called to love like Jesus loves. And as we love like Jesus loves, and I have heard the stories about what your church is doing in this community, and the health fair, and was it a dental fair? I've just heard several things. I just thought, oh, this is such a blessing. And what a way to share that love and to do it in a way for people who don't have the access, they're able to have access to the need to meet their needs, their physical needs. So the world needs us to love like Jesus loves. Where's that start? It starts in our families. It starts with our little kids, with our families. And I remember in our house, I remember that every so often my mom would say, okay, you can have your friend over. And I'd have my friend Billy come over, and he'd come and stay and spend the afternoon and eat supper, and then his dad would come pick him up. Or because in those days we didn't do many sleepovers, but anyway, here's Billy, and we'd have a great time. And then after Billy was gone, you know, I'd start yelling at my brother and my sisters and and my mom, I remember her saying to me, Georgie, she always called me Georgie. She said, Georgie, and I go over and she said, you know what I wish? And I said, what, Mom? And she says, I wish you'd be as nice to your brother and your sisters as you are to your friends when they come over. We'd have a really happy home if you'd be as nice to... Love is where we learn this stuff. We learn to love in the home. But from our home, we have these concentric circles. And for me, that's our next-door neighbors. And then it's the neighbors and the neighbors. And as we go... And for Leanne and I don't know how this ever happened. We never set out to do this. But we lived in the same house. It'll be going on 30 years, which is unbelievable. I still don't understand that. But we've been in the same home for almost 30 years. And I'm a walker. I need to walk. And I some of you know I became very ill. And I had to walk in order to save my life. And that really motivated me. And so I do a lot of walking and have different routes. And one day the Lord said to me, he said, hey, you're serving as a chaplain here at Adventist Medical Center. And back then they called it Portland Adventist Medical Center. But you're serving as a chaplain. I had the privilege of being as a chaplain, the relief chaplain there for like 18 years, and maybe 19 years. And I realized there I was serving the community. Whoever was there, I was engaged with people from all around the whole community. And the Lord just one day just laid on my heart through the Spirit and just said, I'd like you to be a chaplain to your neighborhood. Anybody here ever thought about that, or the Spirit ever speak to you that way? You know, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. So where's the best place? Well, in your own home, and then let it shine all around the neighborhood. I'm going to let it shine, right? So I'd like you to be the chaplain to your neighborhood. And that changed the way that I looked at my neighbors. And not all my neighbors, not everybody's, you know, not everybody's as easy to like as others. Let's put it that way, okay? Anybody know what I'm talking about? Okay? I want you to be a chaplain to your neighbors. And so you just be the light there. And I've had the privilege of being able to pray with different people in different settings after I got to know. And the other thing that helped was is we had these dogs. And we've owned, right now we're heartbroken because we've lost our last two dogs in the last year here, a year and a half. Sisu Honey Bear and Charlie. And Sisu was our third golden retriever that we've owned. And Sisu, oh my, all the Goldens, they are just goodwill ambassadors, you know what I mean? So you're walking down the street with a Golden, and the Golden sees somebody and wants to go over and meet them. And, hi, how are you? I love you. I never met you before, but I love you. So these are the Goldens. So the Goldens are doing, and it probably would have been different if we'd owned pit bulls, I think, just a little. But with the Golden, here we are, we're going around, we're meeting people, and I get to, and I'd say, well, and they say, oh, you have a sweet dog. I say, well, her name is Sisu, and you know, Sisu, well, that's a Finnish word for guts and resilience, and you know, and so we'd have this conversation, and then they always open the door for, oh, and by the way, my name's George, and then they tell me their name. We got to know a lot of people in our neighborhood, and I got to know people far, even way up blocks away from me, I got to know people, and all of this. Well, my dogs both passed, and I was walking, and I'm walking along, and all at once, but well, by the way, if you walk a dog, anybody know what these are? One of these? So, I the little blue bag, and I'm walking along, and I said, oh, someone forgot to bring their bags along. There, oh my, right there. But and I'm just walking like, oh, well, you know, and I just, oh, that's so disgusting. And the Spirit just said to me, is there a bag in your pocket? And I went, oh, yeah, my dogs died, but I forgot to take the bags out. And the Spirit didn't say another, he never said another word, just did this. I said, what? And he went, okay. I said, but it's not my dog. And I said, oh. And then I heard the words very clearly. Do unto others as you have them do unto you. Do you have any grandkids? Yes, I do have grandkids. In fact, we have 9 of them, praise God. What a blessing. Now, if your grandkids are here, would they step in this? Yeah, there definitely are 2 or 3 of them would step in it, yes. Do other people in this neighborhood have grandkids? Yeah. Okay. And I went over and I said, okay. And as I was leaning down, the Lord, and I kind of did the job, you know. And as I stood up and said, okay, the Spirit said one more thing to me. This is your job. And I went, what? It's your job. That's it. 3 words. It's your job. And I thought, oh my. Because I have all these bags left over at the house. Oh my. Who can I give those? I'll give them to Pax. I know. I'll give them to Pax. That way. Get rid of them. No. I got the bags. So there's a neighbor that has made it clear that I think the word that was used was agnostic. And so one day I'm walking along and someone forgot their bag. They didn't have it with them. And so I go over there, and I didn't know, and I hear her yell to me from across the street. You don't have a dog. What? You don't have a dog. What are you doing? I said, it's my job. And she went, so she kind of looked at me like this. So, and we've gotten to know each other over the years. And, in fact, her husband and I became good friends. In fact, he was a wonderful man. He helped me paint his house. I helped him paint my house, and I helped paint. So we had this. So here he is. He's now passed, and that's another story. I shouldn't take so long to tell it, should I, honey? But that he and I actually, after 20 years of him being sick different times and me going to the hospital to visit, after 20 years, me saying, hey, before I leave the hospital, can I pray with you? Ah, preacher, you pray in your own house. And I'd say, okay, praying in my own house for you, okay? So the last time, just before we went off on our travel, we had a sabbatical back in 2016, and before we left, I went to visit him, and he was not doing well, and I said, can I pray with you? And he looked at me and said, if anybody needs it, I do. Whew. After 20 years. and I prayed with him. And we came back from our trip, and he was gone. So this family, you know, here we are. And so she yells across there, "What are you doing? You don't have a dog?" And I go, "Yeah." So a week or so later, I'm walking along, and someone else forgot. So there I am, and I'm down, and I hear, and always, and across the street from it, I hear her say to a lady she's walking with, "That's the guy in the neighborhood that picks up all the dog poop." Okay? So I all at once realized, as I walked away from there, I realized the Lord called me to this job to reach her. It's this thing of me doing this is getting inside her head, and it's messing with her. It's like, what in the world? What? By the way, I want to assure you at the end, it's okay to shake my hand. I scrub very good every morning before I come to church. Okay, I really scrub up, okay? There's another piece in this, and that was our neighbors just across the cul-de-sac, and we got to know them over the years. And by the way, Steve and Beth, and he pastored the Damascus Community Church for 20 years, right next to me while I was pastor. And so we got to know each other over the years. And right there in the last 6 months, they were making a decision to move closer to their kids, and their house was for sale. And I said to Lee, I said, "Honey, let's invite them over." We invited them over. We had supper together. They invited us back over to their house. Then when they were ready and everything was packed and everything, then a big snowstorm hit back in March or whenever it was this year. There was a snow, and all they were living was in a little RV in front of their house. Their stuff was all gone. They didn't have food enough. We had them over again. Anyway, we had this wonderful experience in the last number of months together. And Steve said to me, "Why did we wait 20 years before we ate together? Why did we wait 20 years before we ate together?" Wow. So I'm now saying, "Lord, okay, help us know. Help us, show us who it's going to be. How are you going? Where are you working? Where are you leading here? Because you put us here. We aren't here by accident. There are people in this neighborhood that you love, that you want to see brought to Jesus. So please let us not get in the way of what you want to do through our relationship with our neighbors." Work. I already mentioned the 205. I'm guessing 26 can be pretty rough and rugged too out this way. In fact, I know it can. Someone cut me off this morning. Okay, so whatever. You and I get to exhibit the agape love of Jesus as we drive. In fact, I was driving, this was not too long ago, and when there's a light changing, and it's going to go from, you know, there's two lanes, it's going to go down to one lane, and boom, I pop and I'm up there, and this person raises a rail, and I beat him out, and the Lord says, hello? I mean, you think you're NASCAR? I mean, what are you, this person, what if you bump, and then they rolled over, and the kids got thrown out of the car? I mean, you murder in your heart? I mean, what is this? And then I love driving fast, so this is an area the Spirit is working in my life. And I want to receive that, and I want to drive, and, you know, let's see, what would Jesus, I want to drive like Jesus would drive. How's that one? Drive like Jesus drives, okay? So, the world's a mess. And this world that's in a mess, with all of that, you and I get called to love like Jesus loves. Because the world's in a mess, we as Seventh-day Adventists have come together and put together organizations like Adventist Community Services here in the United States and around the world, Adventist Community Services, and around the world internationally, 125 to 130 different countries, ADRA. ADRA stands for Adventist. Is it Adventist Disaster or Adventist Development? There is disaster. Okay. Adventist Development, by the way, 75% of what ADRA does is development. 75%, 25%, which may mean up to 100 different disasters in a year, including the most recent there, Turkey and Syria with those earthquakes. ADRA was there with many of the other humanitarian agencies. But we are called and get to love like Jesus loves in that way. I have two short videos I want you to see. And the first one is about development. It's from Cambodia. and it's a water project. Let's watch it. The second one will be a disaster, Ukraine.
Our living conditions were bad. We didn't have a toilet. We used to push around our home. My name is Tia Kong. I am 55 years old, and I am from Cambodia. Seeing my children face these problems, I felt helpless. So we would drink any water that we could find. We got diseases, vomiting, diarrhea, coughing. We were taking traditional medicines as I didn't have money to go to a health center or hospital. Adra talked with me about raising chickens, growing veggies, having good sanitation, and building a good latrine. This made me feel hopeful.
This project has been very important. It has changed their life. They have received a lot of benefit from the project so far. The children get more healthy as well as hygiene and sanitation, and a lot more.
Since we received a latrine and a water filter, our family is better. Adra brought change to my family. Our kids could have good health and they are able to go to school.
I love my mom very much. She works very hard to care for me. Now I can go to school.
They are now getting a good education. It is setting them up for the future. It's a big difference. Life is better than before. I would like to say thank you to Adra and the supporters who have helped my family to change our lives. Thank you.
You can give a family the gift of clean water. It makes a world of difference. Donate today at adra.org.au/donate. Thank you for watching. To view another incredible story, take a look at the video here. And if you haven't already, subscribe. And we'll see you in our next video.
We couldn't take shower because there were no hot water. We just were thinking about, are we going to stay alive today or are we going to die? And we were only praying all the time. And thanks God, we are still alive.
Ruslana, I'm staying here in Poland at the church. Well, my family are refugees from Ukraine.
My mom, my siblings, sister and brother. Unfortunately, our father, he's a preacher and he's left in Ukraine.
When the first day of war started, we hoped it will end soon, but it didn't. And the worst part was that our city, Bryansk, was occupied on the second and third days of war, so just from the start, and we couldn't leave the city at all. And the pharmacies, the food stores were completely empty. People couldn't buy food or even like simple medicines. And also we didn't have any network, or we couldn't even call that we are alive. And our grandmother, she was so worried, and we couldn't tell her that we are alive. It was so bad. Majority of us don't have relatives or friends here, and the only people who help is church. The church gonna give us a chance to have a future and help us with the basic things. Here's a bedroom, so we slept here. And it's quite comfortable, it's warm here and nice. And we are really glad that church provided us a place to sleep.
Jesus never asked, who are you? What is your nationality? Are you a good person or a bad person? He was open. And I think this is a good example for us. When we are helping others, it's like Jesus' hands will be through us. We change because of Jesus, of his impact on us. And we want to be his hands. We want to be his feet.
A global humanitarian agency, ADRA, which is
the Venice Development and Relief Agency, ADRA, based here in
Right
now, the organization has people in and around Ukraine, helping the hundreds of thousands of people fleeing.
The groups here at home are getting involved as well.
The Maryland Aid Group is going much farther, 5,000 miles farther, to provide direct help.
It's already providing shelter to refugees in centers and church buildings.
ADRA volunteers crossed the border themselves into Ukraine with this convoy carrying supplies.
When they said, like, don't worry, you can feel like at home here and we will help you because we are your brothers and sisters in God, they just supported us and that meant so much.
God's people said, I mean, this is the privilege, this is the call, this is the privilege we have to be agape lovers and to go into this world to love like Jesus loves. Now, the question of the morning, and I know this lead up, I have now the most important thing to share with you, so please stay with me for another 15 minutes, because here we go. The question of the morning is this: this love that we're seeing in action, like we've seen with ADRA around the world and community services here locally, is this the gospel? Or, could be a trick question, is this the fruit of the gospel? The fruit of the Spirit is? But what verse would you go to capture the meaning of the gospel? It's the most famous verse in the whole Bible. For God, we can say it together, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. The gospel is always about what God has done for us in Christ. Amen? Has anybody memorized 1 John 3:16? Oh, let's go to 1 John 3:16. By this we know love. He laid down his life for us. We ought to lay down our lives for the brethren, for the others. But whoever has this world goods, sees the brother in need, shuts his heart up. How does the love of God abide in him? My little children, love not in word or tongue, but in deed and in truth. John 3:16, root. 1 John 3:16, fruit. Root and fruit, always distinct, never separate. Amen? Always distinct. Let's not confuse and go, oh, because I shared this meal with my neighbor, that now this is what the gospel is. My neighbor will experience that as good news, but it's the fruit of what I have experienced already in what Christ has done for me. Root and fruit, always distinct, never separate. In fact, if it becomes separate, what happens to the fruit? It just dies. Always distinct, never separate. So, Let's do a quiz and just ask the scripture this morning that Dick Hansen read for us, Micah 6:6-8. You know, do justice, love mercy, walk humbly with your God. Is that root or fruit? Yeah, fruit. Ah, well, Pastor George, where's the root there? Look at Micah. Well, let me read through the verse. It's such a powerful. What shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before the high God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, 10,000 rivers of oil? Whoa, here comes the big one. Everywhere, and by the way, you go around the world, you look through world history, and you find cultures around the world doing this where they're going, okay, if I can just give God, give this the power that be, the powers, the gods, whatever, if I can give the spirits, if I can give something really big, then I'll get what I need back. Maybe it's so I can get rain for the crops so they'll grow this year. I'm going to give something really big. And what do? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? Ah! In Jeremiah says to the Jewish people, God's own people, do you know one of Solomon's wives actually brought her God along? And out there in the Kidron Valley, they were taking children out there to be sacrificed to these demon gods. Jeremiah speaks the words, and the Lord just says to the people of Israel, the Jewish people, he just goes, how could you even imagine? What made you even imagine that this is going to be something I have? What he's shown you, what is good, what does the Lord require of you? Do justly, love mercy, walk humbly. Yes, that's what you do as response, and as response to what? Get ready. Verse 4, same chapter, Micah 6, verse 4, here it is. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt. I redeemed you from the house of bondage. Where is Micah quoting from? Yes, thank you. Exodus 20. The first words of the Ten Commandments are not, thou shalt not. The first words of the Ten Commandments are, I brought you up from the land of Egypt, from the house of bondage. Therefore, thou shalt have no other gods before me. It's response. This is so crucial. It's when I say distinct, and always distinct, never separate. Justification, sanctification, always distinct, never separate. Always together in a unity as we respond to God who initiates and gives a gift, and we respond to giving back. This is particularly hard or challenging for us as religious people. This is the religious response all around the world. Most of the religions in the world are based on, if I do this, then my God will give me this. I've got to do this, and then he'll do this. And it's this transaction thing where I am the initiator. I got it. Boom. No. The gospel is different than all the religions of the world. The gospel says, no, it's about what I have done for you. It's the amazing grace. And get this, if you and I have a faith that's rooted in the amazing grace of God's gift to us, and now our 100% wholehearted response to him, love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. I heard someone, actually a pastor, make the statement, this is the gospel. No, it's not the gospel. They asked Jesus, what's the greatest commandment? Love God with all. It's the commandment response to the God who's already given. And as religious people, this is a challenge, whatever religion it is. For us, we are committed to the truth as it is in Jesus. Amen? The truth as it is in Jesus as revealed in the Word of God, Old and New Testament both. Some people, the Old Testament's legalism, the New Testament's grace. No, it's grace all the way through. And the commandments and the call to do what God's will is always a response to what God has given us. Get this. If your religion, your faith is rooted in grace, the grace of God, then the rest of your life will be gratitude. And when you're a person, a man or woman of gratitude, it changes everything. It's not me trying to prove to God how much, now you should like me. No, no. This is the God who's for us, not against us. And if our religion is grace, the rest of our lives just have to be, watch this, get to be just gratitude. And when I go, that's the very experience that Sabbath in Hebrews 4 says, we rest from our works as he did from his on the seventh day. That we live out a grace reality that allows, and that starts in our homes with our own kids. Wow. What a privilege we have. We'll do this quickly. In your bulletin, you're going to see two handouts. I'm going to go very quickly here. But there's two handouts in the bulletin. And I'm going to ask for 10 more minutes now. Okay, here we go. Two pictures. Picture number one. The picture number one is the one with a picture with this one. And if you look down, even with my eyesight, as old as I am, it's like 1876 by James White. And you see here the tree with the law. And over here, you have the cross of Christ, and you have the old, kind of the Old and New Testament, Old and New Testament stories here that are laid out. And James White commissioned at great cost to have this painted by an artist to capture Revelation 14, verse 12. Here is the patience of the saints. By the way, the Advent people said, we're going to be patient. We aren't going to do any more date setting for coming of Christ. This is how they were expressed it. We will be patient. We will no longer set a date for the coming of Jesus. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God. And the Adventists began to say, we'll do everything the Father told us to do in the Old Testament. And the faith of Jesus will do everything the Son told us to do in the New Testament. If we do all those things, up in the upper right-hand corner is what? Heaven. If you can do it all, that, by the way, how many laws did the rabbis discover in the first five books of the Bible? 613. Okay? So when Saul of Tarsus, who now Paul in Philippians 3 says, according to the righteousness of the law, I was blameless. What he's saying is, I checked the box on all 613. I did them all. See? So that picture, 613. Then you go to the New Testament. He says, oh, I had two brothers say to me, oh, isn't it wonderful? The New Testament only has two. Love God, love your neighbor. 613. I said, whoa. First of all, there's a lot more than 613 in the Old Testament. Secondly, guess what? Skip McLarty in his book on In Granite or Ingrained points out that there are more commands in the New Testament than there are in the Old. What? I thought the Old Testament was the Old. So you have this picture. And by the way, we would add in all the things that we have been blessed with in terms of things like health laws and health ways. We could add all kinds of things. And if you're setting out to say, if I can do enough things, then God will accept me. Whew. Oh, what a burden. Never know rest. The rest that we have of salvation by grace through faith in Jesus. Never know that. So here's James. Here's the amazing part. This is in Woodrow Whitten's book called Ellen White on Salvation, page 29 and 30. He talks about James White on his deathbed, actually uses and talks with Ellen. They had deep discussions, and he was dying, and they had deep discussions, and he actually used the word, Ellen, we made mistakes. Ellen, she has quotes there. He has quotes, Woodrow Whitten in his book. And then Ellen actually has quotes with her saying when she spoke to students after his death and said, I made a vow at James' deathbed that there would be a new element brought in to our teaching, and get ready for the new element. Flip your page over. Boom. She goes at a great expense, this is the high tech of their day, at a great expense, hires an artist who paints a new picture. And this new picture has now Christ at the center. And I have people say to me, well, Pastor George, the law just disappeared. And I go, whoa, 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 whoa. Well, in the background there, do you see a mountain with lightning? Yes. What mountain do you think that might be? Well, Sinai, yes. The law has not disappeared. And by the way, more significant than that, the man hanging on that tree as the Lamb of God is the one who said, I always do my Father's will. I always do my Father's will. And he promised us, remember that cup at the supper, the last supper, the remembrance of me at the table? He said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. And the new covenant promise is what? In Christ, through the power of the Spirit, I will write my law on your mind. I will write it on your heart. On your mind, you'll know my will. On your heart, you will desire to do my will. And I'm going to tell you personal testimony. I am never more free than when I want to do what God wants me to do. When I want to do what I ought to do, I'm the freest man in the world. And in Christ Jesus, and in the Spirit, it's the freedom that you and I are being invited to live in. Remember, I said this is all in the context of the third angel's message. In the world we live in right now, God needs us to be these people who are the joy of the Lord is our strength. Our world's going into despair. As Christians, we need to go ahead and eat the full plate Christ has given us and just go, I'm going to live out this in this reality. I'm not going to be trapped in the traps that keep me enslaved to me thinking that I'm the one that initiates when God is the one who gives it through Christ. I love this passage. In fact, on the first page, I write, keep and do. It captures this. If you keep enough and do enough things, then you'll go to heaven. Over here, it's receive. Receive what I have done. Then come follow me. And I'll pour my Spirit into you. We'll be yoked together. And my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And you will find rest for your soul. Ah, good stuff. Good stuff. Let's go to 1 Peter 2:24. Listen to this. He himself, ESV says, he himself, I should pound the butt, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree. There's step one, that's all God. Step two, in order that you and I might die to sin and live to righteousness. By the way, when I do this, what am I doing? I'm used to doing this. I'm baptizing. Baptized into his death, raised up to be a new creation, man and woman, boy or girl, where the old is gone, the new has come. It's all true and it's all reality. And get this, in Christ, if anyone is in Christ, what's it mean in Christ? Here you go. Here's Christ. Here's you and me. Anyone in Christ is a new creation. In Christ, this is all true of me, of you and of me. It's our title to heaven, and the Spirit works out the fitness through sanctification as we walk in step with him. This is the reality and the privilege you and I get to live. Okay, one last step in this thing, and please go with me to this piece. This is the most valuable thing you'll walk away with from here today. You'll forget what I said, you know, probably by tonight, but maybe, okay, some of you will remember something by tomorrow morning. But this piece, if you have this in the pictures, by the way, if you notice the title of the picture, Christ, the Way of Life, I have taken that title and put it on these words because I believe this is the clearest statement of the gospel ever written by an Adventist pen. Sister White wrote it in Steps to Christ, and I believe she is describing right here the picture she had commissioned to make Christ central. We'll do it quickly, but there's some powerful... This is full of gems. The condition of eternal life is now, today, just what it's always been. Just what it was in paradise before our first parents, before the fall of our first parents. What's the condition? Perfect obedience to the law of God, perfect righteousness. I've written in my margin over here, 100%. I used to love to get those every once in a while when my teacher would hand me back a paper. I like to take those home to mom and dad. 100%. If eternal life were granted on any condition short of this, the happiness of the whole universe would be imperiled. The happiness of the whole universe would be imperiled. This raises a question, and I'm just going to ask the question, because the question is, God wants to bring the world back to happiness, and here we have Cain, who's just murdered his brother Abel, and my question is, can God just forgive Cain? In fact, let's ask it this way. Let's do, if you wish to show a hand, how many say God forgives sins? Okay, how many say God does not forgive sins? Here's the answer. God does not forgive sins. Huh? God does not forgive sins. Really? God forgives sinners. What does he do with sins? He goes to the cross and pays the price. Cain and Abel. Here, if Cain had fallen on his knees and said, God, the Lord says, hey, where's your brother? Instead of Cain copping an attitude going, I'm my brother's keeper. Instead of that, if Cain had come and he'd fallen and he said, oh, in a fit of anger, I murdered my brother Abel. Please forgive me. Would God have forgiven Cain? Absolutely, yes. Amen? He'd forgive Cain. And then he would say, I forgive you, Cain. But there's this other little matter. Your brother's blood is crying out to me from the ground. I will answer his cry. I'm going to answer his cry in my own person, the person of my son, as he takes it in the neck for that cost of that blood that was shed. By the way, as I say this, this is really crucial. All of these theories about atonement, oh, Jesus didn't need to die for your sins. Actually, at an Adventist camp meeting several years ago, Jesus could have died at 80 in a rocking chair with a heart attack because he'd shown us what God loved like. Loves like his whole life. He didn't need to go to a cross. That was said, spoken from the platform of an Adventist camp meeting. When you think about this, you know, no. It's so then people say, well, look how mean this is. God is angry at Cain because Cain is sin and God has wrath. And so God goes, what am I going to do? I know, I'll beat up my son. And they go, oh, God is, he's a divine child abuser. He's just, no. God was in Christ. They are one. The triune God is one. This is why this argument in the Adventist Church about Trinity matters so much. If you don't get it right on triune God, you will never get the gospel. Ever. You will be locked forever in some type of works righteousness. But when the three are one, God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. These three in one now. At this point, God was in Christ. Will you please forgive me? I forgive you, and I myself am taken in the neck for you. This is the God that we serve. Let's finish this story out. The whole happiness of the universe would be imperiled. The way would be open for sin with all of its train of woe and misery to be immortalized. Second paragraph. It was possible for Adam, before the fall, to form a righteous character by obedience to God's law. It was possible. But he failed to do this. Because of this, his sin, our natures are fallen. We cannot make ourselves righteous. Since we are sinful, unholy, we cannot perfectly obey the holy law. We have no righteousness of our own with which to meet the claims of the law of God. But Christ, there I should pound again. But Christ has made a way of escape for us. He lived on earth amid trials and temptations such as we have to meet. He lived a sinless life. He died for you. He now offers to take our sins and give us his righteousness. Wow, this is good news. If you give yourself to him, accept him as your Savior, then sinful as your life may have been, for his sake you are accounted righteous. Christ's character stands in place of your character. You are accepted before God just as if you had never sinned. Wow. 100%, I write down here, 100%. This is justification. So over here, I just did a line here and go, this is the justification piece. When she wrote Great Controversy, how many chapters did Ellen White include, Sister White include in Great Controversy on Martin Luther? 5. More on Martin Luther than anybody else in the whole book. And it's out of that Great Controversy writing, and now this new element that she took a vow at James' deathbed that she would bring into the church, she brought in. And she's going, this is it. But remember, she grew up a Wesleyan Methodist. And holiness, she knows holiness matters. John Wesley and Charles taught these words. They knew. And so she doesn't take and just lop this off and go, oh, well, we're just a... She goes, no, no, root and fruit, distinct, but never separate. Look at the next paragraph. More than this, Christ changes the heart. He abides in your heart by faith. You would maintain the connection with Christ by faith and the continual surrender of your will to him. So long as you do this, he will work in you to will and to do according to his good pleasure. So you may say, the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith of the Son of God, who loved me, gave himself for me. Jesus said to his disciples, it's not you that speak, the Spirit of your Father speaks. He said, the Spirit is so engaged in our lives, we actually say the right words the Spirit gives us to speak to somebody. Wow. Then Christ, then with Christ working in you, you will manifest the same Spirit and do the same good works, works of righteousness and obedience. Last paragraph sums it all up. We have nothing in ourselves of which to boast. By the way, I never forget the day when it just suddenly hit me. I went, it's all gift. This thing, every heartbeat. Did anybody here do something yesterday that you deserve to wake up this morning? You did something so good yesterday that God, you deserve to wake up. Are you kidding? This is all gift. Every breath, every heartbeat. It's me receiving gift and with gratitude now, using 100% of my energy to love like Jesus loves in this world. Nothing to boast. We have no ground self-exaltation. Our only ground of hope is in the righteousness of Christ imputed, accounted to us, and in that wrought by his Spirit working in and through us, always distinct, never separate. We end with this. We end with this. Matthew 24:14. Because our world needs this. This good news of the kingdom. The good news of the kingdom is going to be preached in the whole world, starting in your home and in your neighborhood and in your workplace and on Route 26. All those places. You and I are called to be three things. We're the people of hope. We're the good newsers. And number three, we are the agape lovers. In the Spirit of Christ, letting his light shine. And I love it in John 1. He says, the darkness will never overcome it. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. Let's sing this together as we stand and give God the glory. love the gospel just pouring through this song to us.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus Christ
and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
When
darkness seems to veil his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. Every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Both his covenant and blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand.
All other ground is sinking sand. When
he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then hear him be found. Glad in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand.
All other ground is sinking sand.
And all God's people said, and all God's people shouted, hallelujah. I have a confession to make. And this is to people who've known me for almost 30 years. But I have often preached the gospel and loved that gospel because it answered the deepest need of my heart. But I've often preached it not in the context of the three angels. And the Lord has laid on my heart that that is what now, more than ever, that I was short, and that what is needed now more than ever is the gospel proclaimed in the context of the three angels. That this is the time in which we live. How did Conrad Vine say it last Sabbath? He said, the time is now. His second message there, the Sabbath, last Sabbath. It's now. The time has arrived. And the gospel of Jesus Christ is what we stand on as the winds blow. But we are clad in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. Amen? Maranatha, come quickly, Lord. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you for the privilege to be together as the people of God, and to open the Word of God and have your Holy Spirit be our teacher as these words of Scripture speak to us. Thank you for this good news of Jesus Christ. Thank you that Christ crucified, risen, ascended, reigning on high on that throne of God, coming soon to bring us home. And so, Lord, we just give ourselves to you and your purpose this day. Thank you that we can face this day clad in your righteousness alone. We are faultless to stand before the throne. And so we say yes to you this day. God, please, through your Holy Spirit, fill us with your Spirit. Early rain, latter rain, fill us with the Spirit, that we might be those who love like Jesus loves, and that many, many will come to the kingdom through the message of Christ that is shared through us and to others all around the world, we pray. In the name of Jesus, and all God's people said, and all God's people shouted, hallelujah.